Good day and welcome to my YouTube channel. I am Atu Francis Deban. Today we are going to be taking on carbohydrate. Carbohydrate is a polymer that is made up of thousands kind of monomers. And it's a compound generally that comprises of carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. So we're going to classify our carbohydrate into the monosaccharide, disaccharide, oligosaccharide and polysaccharide. So we're going to start with the monosaccharide. The monosaccharide are simple sugars such as glucose, fructose, galactose, etc. that could be combined to give us what? Our carbohydrate, which is a polymer. These guys are monomers. And in this monosaccharide, they constitute a peculiar functional group, which could be aldehyde or the ketone functional group. So those of them that contain the aldehyde, they are called the aldo trios, when there are three aldo tetros and there are four pentoses and hexoses. And those that have the keto, we have the ketoses, let's just call them that way, the aldoses, the ketoses, which one of them should be fructose. So let's break it down and see what we can do. We start with the first simple sugar, which is the glyceraldehyde. This is our glyceraldehyde, which contains our functional group, which is the aldehyde group, and also contains the OH group, the OH functional group in it. But this defines it. So it contains one OH, that is three carbon atoms, and one OH. These are trioses, and this is the first member of the trioses that contain what? An aldehyde, what? Functional group. Those that of the trioses that have a keto group, we have example. The trioses we have. This one has a keto group in between, and it's also a triose, which means it contains three carbon atoms. So we are going to talk about the D compounds. When we say a compound has a D, for example, we have the hexoses like fructose, D-glucose, and all that. So we'll be able to define what actually makes it a D. Let's take it, for example, this compound, the glyceraldehyde, this is D-glyceraldehyde. Why? Because the OH group is at the right side. If it is this other way, this is the L-glyceraldehyde. This is the D. Why? Because the OH is at the right. Let's look more of this D and L structures. Let's take the glucose, for example. This is our glucose, the structure of glucose. This is called D-glucose, because it rotates the plane polarized like to the right. This is the D, the last OH, before, second to the last OH, is at the right side, it makes it a D. But if it is at the left, it makes it an L glucose. This one is a D glucose. So if I have this, this is an L glucose. So, in the monosaccharide, like I said earlier on, we have the trioses, we have the tetros, the trios, we have the glyceraldehyde, the tetros, we that has four, this thing, we have the erythrose, for example. So this is our erythrose in the, as a member of the what? The tetroses, which means the four, the sugars that have four carbon what, atoms. We also have the pentoses. Example, we have ribose. So our ribose also have what? Our 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 carbon atoms. So it's an example of what? The pentoses. So let's look at the hexoses, which are the 6 carbon atoms. Then we'll look at our glucose and others. So, by this, we understand our monosaccharides, which are the simple sugars. We have the various structures to illustrate what they are. And we've been able to see that those that have the aldehyde group, they are called the aldoses. For example, this one is having an aldehyde group and a 6 carbon atom, so they are aldohexoses. And this is an aldo, this is a keto or hexoses, because it contains a keto functional group. And they have what our various OH group attached to them. Now, these sugars cannot be simplified further. They are in their simplest form. That is why we call them monosaccharides. They have one molecule of sugar in them. Now we have the disaccharide. Let's move into disaccharide. Disaccharide are sugars that contain 2 molecules of monosaccharide, which means 2 molecules of monosaccharide have to combine within themselves to give us 1 disaccharide, and we can hydrolyze it, break it down back to the monosaccharide. Alright? So let's go to the disaccharide and see practical examples how we can bond the monosaccharide together to get what we want and so on. Okay? So let's take our first example here. So now, in the disaccharide, I said that disaccharide has to do with 2 monomers. Let's take, for example, maltose. It's the first example. This is our maltose. It contains 2 molecules of glucose. So we have glucose plus glucose. That being was what? Maltose. So now, in order for us to be able to bond them together, we have to be able to form our ring structure. The ring structure of glucose, which are the pyranoses. So we have to learn how to do that. When we know how to get the pyranose structure of glucose, then we can now mesh the 2 of them together to get what we want. So let's take a practical example. If this is alpha D glucopyranose. Now, if we know too well that this is our glucose structure, if this is our glucose structure, then how then do we use this to get this? Because we cannot mesh the 2 of them together without forming a pyranose structure, which is a ring structure. And in the process of doing that, there is a condensation reaction that must take place, which has to do with the removal of what? A molecule of water. So, if this is what I'm having, and I've been told that 2 of them have to merge in both alpha position of 1,4 to give me what I want, then how do I get this? So the business now becomes interesting. How do we arrange the structure in a manner in which we call it alpha? That is 1. 2, how then do we get our D inclusive and then the final structure? Because the structures are what? Relatively unique to the particular monomer which we are going to use. It could be galactose, it could be fructose, it could be anything. So our business now is, first, how can we get this? That becomes our interest. If we know how to get this, then we will know our various reactions that will take place. So first of all, let's start by forming our pyranoses to see how we can go about that. So I will take the first example with that to see how we get here. So, the first way in which we get our pyranoses is this. We have our CHO here. And this is it. this is my glucose. Now, this is the D glucose. The formation of the D is going to move over here to mesh with this. This is our first step. Let's move to the second step. Remember, this guy is going to give us our ozone group in the middle. So I go again. I have my CH2 here. And this is the first one. So I have taken my hydrogen. This one is going to go. So I'm not including it. So I have the next one here, OH. The next one comes. Hydrogen. And here the next. OH. And this one now give us our OH out. If I like to put it that way. And this is my hydrogen. So this is coming over here. This is our oxygen in the middle. And this comes over here. This is our second step. Now the third step, which defines whether it is alpha or beta, depends on the position of this OH. So I'm going to move. I want to get an alpha position. So this is what I have. This is my C. This guy could be here, CH2, OH, and I have hydrogen here. So I've taken care of it. The second one here is my OH, hydrogen, third, hydrogen, and OH, the third, OH, and hydrogen. And this is the fifth now, which is the most important. If this OH is at the right side, it is called alpha. If it is at the left like this, it is called beta. So let me put it this way. So this becomes my alpha. So this goes. This is how it is. This is our next step. So the last one, which I'm going to compress. So don't mind me, let me make use of this so that we're not going to be lost. So I want to compress this into what I want. I have the pyranol structure. So this is what I got here. Now, this is at the right. It comes down. Alright? It comes here, OH. This is at the right. Any of the components here, which is found at the right, comes down. And the one at the left goes up. So if this at the right is down, the one at the left, hydrogen, is up. The next one, OH, is down. Hydrogen is up. The next one, hydrogen is down, OH is up. The next one, OH is down, and hydrogen is up. And the last one is my CH2OH. So by this, I have my alpha D glucose pyranose. This is now the structure. And this is what will take place in the reaction. So if you do not know how to get this, it becomes almost impossible for you to mesh your two glucose molecules with the condensation reaction that accompanies it, which has to do with the elimination of water molecule to give you what you want. So now we know how to do this. Let us proceed then to see how we can now react the glucose and the glucose, which is this and this, to get what we want. So let me take this out now so we can proceed. Okay, now we know how to get our glucose structure. Let's proceed now. Now I want to react them. Remember I said the condensation reaction takes place. What is condensation reaction? It has to do with the elimination of what? One water molecule. And the reaction has to do with our one, the position of one. If I want to number them, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. The same thing goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Now, the reaction is always between 1 and 4. The hydroxyl group of 1 and that of 4. So, in these two of them which are about to react, if we take out the molecule of water here, we'll be left H2. These two H and 1O will be gone and oxygen will be left. So, in that vein, this is what I now get.
The oxygen layer, this is the oxygen, and this is my bonding. This is a reaction. So this is alpha D glucose pyranoxyl. Position here is carbon 1 and 4. So I have 1, 4 alpha D glucose pyranoxyl. That is the name for this compound, because the reactor was focused between carbon 1 and carbon 4. So that is how we have 1,4. And the structure here is alpha. If this is alpha, you see the OH is down. If it is beta, it is up. The alpha I meant is this, and beta position is this, and gamma and so on. But we're dealing with alpha and the beta position. So 1,4 alpha D glucose pyranoxyl. So this is what we get. So in disaccharide, which has to do with the condensation reaction of two monomers of glucose to give us our maltose. And we have other ones which we are going to illustrate. So let me take this out so we can proceed. Two, we have the lactose. Lactose have to deal with glucose and galactose. So we have to first of all draw our structures of this glucose and galactose, that we know what we are condensing. We have to form the ring structures, then we know how we are going to react them. So we know the ring structure of glucose, obviously. So let's take the open structure of galactose first. So we have our CHO here. One, two, three, four, five, six. This is the structure of galactose. So if this is galactose, remember, in our ring structure, the next thing we're going to get, let's call this is the C. One of it will give us our own niche in order to save time from going over and over and over. Yeah, this guy is going to go. So this one will be left. So here give us our, if I like, I call it CH2OH and hydrogen that is here, and hydrogen. So if this is formed, this one is gone to form that ring structure, the other one. So this is what where we are. We go with the other ones, which is 1, 2, and 3. The first one here is OH at my right, OH at my left, and the last one, OH at my left. So if I have this is the pyranoxyl structure. Then now I can give us our ring structure, which will always be this. From here, this is alpha, because the OH is at the right. Now, this other one is alpha L, because the, okay, remember the last OH before we make our substitution was at the right. Look at it here, which we took it out to do the reaction. So this is alpha D. Now this is the one that comes next, but we've taken our D already. So here, my OH is at the right, so it's down, and this one is up. The second OH is down, and this one is up. The third one, OH is up. Hydrogen is down. The fourth one, OH is up. Hydrogen is down. And the last one, I have my CH2OH. And this is my hydrogen. This is alpha D galactosyl. Or let's just call it galactose for now. We've not met it. So that's my alpha D galactose. So now I have to take this out to show the condensation reaction, how that works. So let's take this out. So in the second stage, I want to bring my glucose and merge it with the galactose. So if this is my glucose, now this is going to go, my OH in carbon 4 is at the upside, and that of alpha position this other way is at the downside, which means my reaction is going this way. So if I take out a molecule of water here, I will be left with H2O plus oxygen. H plus H is H2, one oxygen up, then the oxygen left is what I'm going to use. So in condensation reaction, it has just taken place and that will occur. So now let's go. I have my oxygen in between, and this becomes my reaction now. The reaction between glucose and galactose goes in this form. So now this becomes alpha D glucose pyranosium 1,4 alpha D galactoside. Just to merge it all together. So by this, we'll be able to get our second monosaccharide, our second disaccharide, which is the lactose. Then the other one is, what's the name? Where we're going to deal with that of fructose. Let's see, let me take that out. But before we start with that of fructose, we must know that fructose is a keto sugar. And we'll be able to do our normal condensation reaction of the keto sugar, and we'll proceed further. Alright, my keto sugar here, I have CH2OH. This is fructose. Now I have to form my restructure. In this case, this is where we're going to attack the double bond of the O. And we are going to take this to come down here. So our structure will take another form. It's not going to be a pyranose structure, it's going to be a furanose structure, furanoside. So, first of all, let me put down what we're going to get here. This is the form in which it's going to come. So let's condense this and see what we get. First, the OH here will move to come here. And here, remember, we're going to have our OH and hydrogen form there. So the next step here will give me, let's take double, CH2OH. CH2OH. When that happens, I will be having my, let's call it OH there, and what? Hydrogen here. But, good. Now this is what we're going to be having. We're going to break this down, kind of, but I'll show you how. Now let's proceed. We are having our OH here, and hydrogen. The next one, OH and hydrogen. And this is the one that moved. So it was hydrogen here, and this goes to give us this. Let's just put it there. So if that is what we're having, now the last structure would be this. Here, I'm having my, that is going to be in that form, CH2OH and hydrogen. Here, up, remember this is 1 and this is 2. I have OH at the right and the carbon 1 is CH2OH. So this is 1, this is 2. Just 1 and 2. Now, in the next carbon here, I have hydrogen and OH here. I move to the next, which is OH and hydrogen. So this is 1, 2, this is 3, 4, and 5, and 6. So, if I want to position this based on either alpha or beta, this is alpha. So this becomes, I want to translate it down here. My OH is at the right. My CH2OH is at the left. We come down here again. We have hydrogen at right side and OH that are away. We come over here, OH down. Hydrogen is up. And the last one here, I have hydrogen down. I have CH2OH. This is fructose, alpha D fructose furanos. Alpha D fructose furanos. So, if I want to react this molecule with any of glucose, maybe of glucose, the reaction is going to be between carbon 1 of glucose with carbon 6 of fructose. So the whole naming process changes. So let's see, let's do one of that to see the other part of the diacyclic before we can move further. So we can move over here, let me put it here. This is my CH2. It's going to have, it's having OH there, so the OH will come down here. This is the O, and this come here. This is how they bond. So this is 1,6. Let me write the name. So this is alpha D glucose pyranosyl 1,6 alpha D fructose furanoside. So furanoside, this is the structures for 4. We can actually condense a glucose from the pyranose to a furanose. All depends on what we want or what is required. The question may be asked that you should react alpha D glucose pyranosyl 1,4 or 1,6 alpha D glucose furanoside. So it changes from pyranose to furanose, which means the structure must come in this form. Now, how you change the open structure of glucose to this is what matters, and that is it. So, having said that, let's proceed further. You know the situation, how to convert them to their pyranose structures and furanose structure. So, we shouldn't waste much time on disaccharide. Let us move further to polysaccharide. For example, now, if you were still having your, how to get the fructose, having furanoside, OH. This is it. All hydrogen in place. If I want a furanose structure, I will take this instead of taking this OH for reaction with this. So, this is what I will now deal with. So on and so forth. Once you understand that, you can do use the same principles to get what you want, and that is fine. So now let's look at, we are done with monosaccharide, with disaccharide. Let's look at oligosaccharide. Oligosaccharide is just a polymer that consists between 1 to around 30 monomers of glucose. So that's oligosaccharide. Now polysaccharide has to deal with more than sometimes 1,500 to 3,000 molecules of monomers of this glucose, fructose, galactose to give us that. Let's take example, cellulose. Cellulose is said to be the most abundant polysaccharide in nature. It is always formed by the reaction, condensation reaction of monomers of glucose in the alpha beta position, that is 1,6 position or alpha beta position, continuously to give us what we want. And the situation ranges in thousands of them about 1,500 to about 6,000 molecules. In a linear form, they are all in a straight chain. Unlike amylopectin, glycogen, they have a branch chain structure. Let me just use one to give us an example before we go down to the reactions of sugars. So let's take on, let's look at cellulose. Yes, cellulose is good. Okay. They say, we said that the bonding is always in alpha, beta position. So this is 1,4. If this goes, if I want to bond it, 1,4, 1,4. But if I'm looking at a beta position of glucose, okay, that bonding process is going to come this way. The oxygen positions are going to come this way. So that goes. The beta position of glucose is this. My OH is up. Okay? And here, where is one? OH is up. And so on and so forth. So, the beta structure of this will react with the next one. And so on and so forth. So, I'm going to have something like this. So, if this is my structure, I have my OH here for glucose. Okay, if this is my beta position, it means that the condensation reaction is going to be between this and this. Between this and this. So, I can easily bring my O here. I take this out. Yeah, I do the same thing. I take this out. And so on and so forth. But, mind you, I'm going to have something like this. My end, which shows that the chain continues in this manner endlessly. It goes to that 6,000 molecules of base reacting in this format. So if this is true, how then can we hydrolyze this to get our glucose back? Hydrolysis takes place. But certain reactions too can occur when we are dealing with what? Cellulose. We do not have much space. So first of all, we can react this with ethanol chloride in the presence of H2SO4. So if I have this, CH3OCl, ethanol chloride, and I have in the presence of an acid, SO4. Now, when this happens, I do not have the space to take down, but this is what you get. I want to replace the reaction in this molecule. So take the reaction here to be your second step. In the second step, you have all these places will be replaced by the sulfate. This is because and all the other OH become C double bond O CH3. This is what you get. When you react this in the presence of an acid, then when you proceed further, having gotten this structure, when you proceed further hydrolysis, now in the hydrolysis, all the OSO3H will be lost to give you back your OH group, and that becomes your final structure. So after this structure, the next one, if you're having your book, where we remove the hydrolysis with H2O with our water there, all of this will go. All the O SO3 will go back to OH. Back to OH. And back to OH. So this is what you get. So we're talking about cellulose. We talk about the reactions of cellulose. How it reacts with ethanol chloride in the presence of an acid to give us this. All these acetate. These are 1,2-diacetate. triacetate in this other form. So that is that about that. So I don't want to talk much about the polysaccharide structures. We all just know that, for example, if we're talking about glycogen, it has to do with a whole lot of thousands of monomers of what? Glucose, which are bonded in a, not a straight chain, not just a linear, in a branch chain, where we have the one for, some of the molecules are bonded in 1,4 linear and some 1,6 branch chain. And that continues. Even amylose does the same thing. Amylopectin, another polysaccharide, happens to do the same thing. And that trend continues. But let's move down to reactions of sugars so that we can wrap up this topic. Reactions of sugars. Let's take the first one, oxidation. Now, in oxidation, we have mild oxidation of glucose, for example, which converts the aldehyde group into an alkaloid acid. For example, let's take this one. So, the oxidation, mild oxidation takes place with bromine water. And when that happens, we now have gluconic acid. So this is a gluconic acid. In mild oxidation of all glucose, it converts the aldehyde group into a carboxylic group. This is mild oxidation. But in intense oxidation, where we use trans-nitrifive acid or nitrous, what we get is to convert both aldehyde group and the hydroxyl group into what? Carboxylic groups. Let's see a practical example of that. So if I change this from here, and here we have HNO3. This is what we get. So this is a compound, we call it the aldaric acid, which has the both ends to be converted into what? Carboxylic group. We're talking about reactions of what? Glucose. Let's look at reduction. We look at what? Reduction. And we have many of them. How many should we look at? Okay. Let's go to Kilianni feature synthesis of what? This. Okay. In this reaction, it tends to increase the length of the sugar molecule to an extra carbon atom. We are going to take ribose, which is 5. When we are done, we convert it to allose, which becomes 6. Let's take this. Alright, we first move with sodium cyanide. We have, remember, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We are still going to get this. Okay. So when I have this, this is what I get.